Hello, everybody. Welcome to today's Simulation Lab seminar. We have the good fortune to have the one and only Arne Tobias Elva here from the Process Engineering Group. And today he's going to talk to us about a topic that we all know and love, plotting and GNU plots. So without any more nonsense, Tobias, please.
Thank you, Brian. Thank you for the introduction. Yes, today I will talk a bit about GNUplot and plotting in general. When I initially started, I was thinking that I wouldn't like to stand here and talk about different commands in GNUplot all the time, but make it a bit more general. I didn't quite succeed in that, so there will be some small commands that you have to survive through, but hopefully it won't be too boring. So, to start with, I'm absolutely no expert in GNUplot. What I present today is based on my experience, what I learned from what I have been doing before. So my experience started back in 2012 or something like that, when I took a course, modeling course, at the third grade here, where I was asked to plot something in GNUplot, and I didn't manage to do it. And the next year I took the C++ course, and there was no plotting environment included, so I had to use something to plot, so then I shortly started using GNUplot. And the summer after that, I got a summer job in an oil company where I had to plot different production data for different oil fields every day, so to use for analyzers. And of course, the company didn't have any MATLAB license, which I was used to do for plotting there, and if I tried to plot anything in Excel, which they had, the memory went out. So then I had to use GNUplot, and that actually worked. And so ever since that, I have been using GNUplot and happily. But these slides are not completely my own work. I also had the help from my good colleagues, Tore Haugo Aberg and Sigve Karolius. So they don't at least disagree about what I'm about to present here. And I also will present some parts, which is a part of the first year course in process engineering. And also some parts for different courses I have been having here at NTNU. So to start with, usually when I work, I'm a programmer, so I start with coding. From the results from my code, I write over to a data file. At the same time, I would like to verify this data, so then I derive some kind of expression, probably usually from literature, which I compare it to. And I compare the expression and the data file in some plotting environment, and then I need to have one output to the screen so I can confirm that my results are good. And I also would like to have one output as saved as a figure. So, plotting. We all do it. There exist many tools for plotting. So now I would like to have some kind of raise of hand to sort of determine the demographic of the audience here. So if you're used to using Python and Matplotlib, some raise of hand, yeah, someone there. What about ticks and PGF plots? Yeah, quite many. MATLAB, almost everybody. Octave, anyone? No. If you use Octave, then you already use GNUplot. But SigmaPlot, anyone? Yeah. Plotly, no, probably not. GNUplot, anyone familiar? Kind of, yeah. Excel, yeah. And R. None. So we can divide these different plotting tools into groups. You have, for instance, Python, Octave, and MATLAB, which is integrated as a part of programming languages. And you have ticks, which is mainly to produce plots for LaTeX. And then you have Excel, Plotly, R, kind of, and SigmaPlot, where you import data and make file. So, but all these tools basically do the same task. So when you want to produce a plot by programming, you basically do the same as you would do by hand. You start off with a blank piece of paper. Important thing, you need to have it big enough so you can plot what you want to do.
C1 plot.
see what you plot at least, and have it big enough to, yeah. And then you probably would draw some kind of axis starting from the bottom and up and have the axis to be long enough. And then basically you import data by hand, you sort of import them first. And after that you do add a line to see if, usually it's a line from each point to point, but it could, for instance, be some other line. You could have a step line, but basically you add some kind of, do something with the data sets you have. And finally, you add different axis titles, add some extra fanciness for you to interpret your plot. And if you look at the different programming languages then, plotting tools, so here is an example in PGF plots. So these examples here are gathered from the first year course in process engineering this year. So you see you have the same procedure here. You start off by drawing some kind of, making your piece of paper to be here 10 by 10 centimeters. And then you add some information to the different axes. You say what kind of axes you want, blah, blah, blah. You set the length of them, set the value. And then after that, you add the different data points, which you get from this file here. And then you say how it should be interpreted. And at the end, you add some legends to explain your data set. So here we have Python. It's a bit less code, but you have not as many options as you have in PGF plots. You import the library, set the size here as well, add some information to how you want it to be treated, you load the data, and then plot it here and determine how you plot the different data points. There you do, well, yeah, I don't see it from here, but, and at the end you add some legends and some plot information. And as you see, the story starts to repeat itself. In MATLAB, you set the paper size to be 10 by 10. You start the figure. You import the data. So everything you basically do is the same. And also in Excel, it's basically a script itself. You just use your mouse and your hand to produce the plot there. So you see the same plot and the same data. And finally, GNUplot, no surprise. You start by setting the size of how big you want it to be plotted, add some information, for instance, about how length of the axis, how often you want to have these small lines here, and then, yeah, and then you plot the data at the end using in some kind of input file. And then afterwards, down here, I add the legends. It's a bit longer, but didn't fit in the page here. So GNUplot is a command line based graphing utility made for plotting data files, plotting analytical functions, and also do some curve fitting. Today, I'm going to focus on the two first points because I haven't really done the third point there. GNUplot is, the source code of GNUplot is copyrighted, but it's freely distributed, so that means you can use it for whatever you want. And it's a command line program. So if you're not used to using the command line, then it could be a bit tricky getting started with GNUplot. But if you do it, then it works quite well. So the homepage of GNUplot, you can find it is www.gnuplot.info. Here you can find, if you want to install it, you could either download some files or if you can download it with some package manager or some kind. On this webpage, you only also find a manual, which is very long and very thick and describes very thoroughly how to use the different commands. But there are also some examples included and a tutorial. Personally, when I want to start with a GNUplot, I often start with an example and then actually modify that more or less. So to fit what I need to present. So what can you do with GNUplot? You can produce it's specifically designed to produce figures, either for presentations or for something else. And you can also manipulate directly on the figure if you use it correctly. You can produce 2D plots, you can produce 3D plots, and you can even produce GIF figures if you want to. That I do only for fun, but and contour plots. And you can select whatever output format you want. You could either do PDF, EPS, TIX, and TEC files, and even HTML. So there are two concepts you need to be aware of before you start plotting with Gnuplots. The first one is different terminals. The terminal determine which output format you get from your plot. So the most common ones are the ones I use most frequently is, for instance, PNG Kaibo, which produces a PGN figure, PNG figure, and I use a PostScript to produce PostScript figures, and also this DOM terminal, which only produces an ASCII tech file. It's not so useful, but it's quite funny. I can show you a bit later. And you also have some interactive plotting terminals, so if you want to see your plot directly. Depending on which operating system you are using, for instance, if you're using Mac, you want to use the Aqua usually. I use Linux, so then it's useful to have the VXT, and that one you can also use for Windows, I believe. I'm not really sure. And if you want tech output, you usually select the EPS LaTeX terminal. The data files of Gnuplot, you communicate with Gnuplot from a data file. And the data files has to be arranged in columns. So if I want to plot some axes against each other, then I have this one as one, that's the x-axis, and then I have the y data here in different columns. So you plot your data downwards instead of, and that's quite important. So now I'm going to show you some Gnuplot. So to get Gnuplot started, you start with a terminal. So to get started there, I'm just going to get my sheet notes. Start off by to open Gnuplot, you type Gnuplot. So this is how Gnuplot looks like when you open the terminal. To determine which output format you can use or which one you have available, you type set terminal like this. And here you see a bunch of the available terminals that you can use. Personally, I don't use many of them. I use 2 or 3, something over 4. For instance, it's APS LaTeX, and then this LaTeX, and I have a JPEG. So those are the terminals we can use. So for now, we want to use this terminal here, which is a VXT terminal. So it's a window that opens afterwards. So then I type set terminal VXT. And then I can plot wherever I want. For instance, I could type plot X. And then I get up this window here, where I have plotted X as a function of Y, essentially. But usually you would like to plot some kind of data file. So I have this data file here, which I have called data.txt. So that's the same data file as I showed you before. Then I want to plot this column here, use that one as the x-axis, and have two different series as the y-axis. This is from a common filter, where I filtered some spectroscopy data. So, Brian?
I mentioned before, it just has to have spaces to see the difference.
Yeah.
Columns. So here you also have the comma delimiting.
Yeah.
So it doesn't matter.
It doesn't really matter, no.
Just as long as the space is there.
No, you can also use commas. First, it searches for spaces. If it doesn't find that, it uses the commas. So yeah, this was a bad example. Sorry, it should have been. Yeah. So then I open gnuplot again, and then I set terminal vxt. Let's type it correctly. And then I type plot, and then name of the file. And then I say using plot the data file, using the first column as the x-axis and the second column as the y-axis. And here I get the data in. So simple as that. And if I want to add the other one, the other column, I use the same format, starting with plot data.txt using 1, 2. And in addition, I add data.txt using 1, 3. Where did that one go? Yeah. So here you see I get also in the filter data from the second column. And if I want to add something more, I just add another comma here, comma, and then I want the constant line just to show that I can do that. And then you see, you may not, I see it from here at least, there is a constant line going here. So this is the interactive terminal. So if I then want to use another output format, for instance, I want to have it produce a PNG figure, then I set terminal, and the PNG is called PNG Cairo. Yeah, and then I can just plot the same thing again. And this is the tech version of the PNG file. So I need to add some other information there. So then I have to set an output format. So then I set output and give it a name, data.png, like that. And then I do the same plotting again. And let's look at how the data file turned out. And then I close the gnuplot, sorry, and open data.png. So here is the PNG version of the using the same, so now it's stored as a PNG figure. But if you think it's a bit annoying to start the terminal each time and type all those commands, you could also save it as a script. So then you open a fresh text file, and just type in set terminal, the same thing as we did here. Set terminal to PNG Cairo, set the output format to data.png, and use the same plotting line, plot data.txt, which is the text file, using the first column as the x-axis, the second column as the y-axis, and do the same, but here you use the first axis as the x-axis and the third axis as the y-axis. And also add this one here, the constant. You save it as main.gp. You don't have to use main, and you don't really have to use .gp. That's what I use, just to separate the different file types from each other. And then I can run this script directly from the terminal, typing gnuplot main.gp. So I can do that as well. Gnuplot main.gp. And yeah, then I produced the same figure again, essentially. So it's still there, but yeah. So there are also some other commands that you can do in Gnuplot. For instance here, this is I hand lifted this example from another presentation that I found online. I select some make a data file, which has some measurements data on the x value and the y value. Also included is some error bars, or some error, how much you expect, respectively, either in the x-axis and the y-axis. To plot this here, I select the terminal. I set the name of the output file. I give it a title, which you can see here. I set a label on the x and the y-axis. And I set some kind of range where I want it to be valid from. And then I plot, first I plot the data file, which is this one here, using the different columns. So the first column is the x-axis, the second column is the y-axis, and then I select the third one, third axis to be the error in the x direction, and the fourth column to be the error in the y direction. And then I use some kind of, this one you can Google, that is, then I add this cross that you see here, and I give it a title. And I also want to compare it with an analytical expression. So I set plot two different values here. So the output from when I run this script, then I get this figure here as an output. You see the different sizes of the crosses. So for instance, this one, there is a lot of expected error in the y-axis on the second to last data set, which is here, which is 0.4, which is a lot bigger than the other ones. And here in the middle one, you see one for the bigger error for the x-axis. And that should be that one there. So that's a 2D plot. You could also do 3D plots in Gnuplot. Similarly here as well. Start up setting the size. You can set the size of the output format. You set the name of the output format you would like to have, and can give it a title. I say the size of the different ticks I want, and also get some offset, because when printing in 3D, it looked better, so I can move where these one are drawn a bit in the X, Y, and Z direction. Here I say that I don't want any ticks on the Z axis. Instead, I use a color box, which is this one, which I can set the size of. I say I have a snow border and I want it to be horizontal. I define that I use plotting a surface and set some ranges. And here I set the view in which direction I want to look the plot at the plot from in degrees. I don't need any legends because I only have one data set here. And I set the color map. This is, a color map. And then I use another command, which is splot, which is surface plot. Then I plot the data file, which is this one. So here, for different temperatures, I have certain fractions of some species, and I have an energy. So I calculate the energy of that reaction depending on the fraction of this substance here. Yeah,
fine. You can arrange the columns in any order in your data.
Yeah, sure, you can. So, you could plot using first axis, first, and then third, and then second axis just to flip it. That's no problem. That is the term. This number here refers to which column in your data file. And this PS here is the size of each point, how big I want them to print. And here I don't really, not so interesting to see every point, but more the surface of the plot itself. So you could do, so this is the output of this one. You see I have the horizontal error bar. I have a title. And I have some, they are not directly on the axis, these ticks here, they're a bit offset from the standard. In addition, there is also possible to do histograms. This one is a bit different because here I generate a function within the gnuplot script itself to determine which the size of where it ends up in the final plot. So I calculate which histogram it, which bar it belongs to, the measurement. There again, it's the same. I set the range of the x-axis, set the range of the y-axis. I set how many ticks I want, starting from the first one, and then how many I want in the end, how the step size of each tick, and then the end. I set the box width to be the same as what I've calculated here, so the, how big each of these is supposed to be in the output format. Then set some names and some labels, and then I plot a data file using, and then at this dollar sign 8, that says that I use the 8th column in my data file. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So I use this column here. I don't remember why I selected that one, but that was the reason. And then I use this smooth frequencies, that is that for each time it calculates, gets one instance of this one, it adds another one. So instead of plotting only one here, if I have a second one, it adds to another one, so it gets two. So here I count the number of each boxes here. And then I add another from another data file. I use the same column. U is a shortcut for using. And pretty much the same as before. And the output there is histograms, where I have this one compared to, this is the kinetic energy of some billiard balls which are colliding over time. And then I have the kinetic energy, many of the heavier ones have a small located here, and the smaller ones are here. So having established what you can do with gnuplot, it's, I was thinking to show you a bit how to do it and how to include that in LaTeX files. So the first thing you do when you want to produce a gnuplot figure is to select one for LaTeX. You select one of the LaTeX terminals. My personal favorite is EPS LaTeX. That one produces an EPS figure, which is completely plain without any text included. And it also produces a tech file, which you that after takes in this plain EPS files and add the text on top of it. So here you see you get the text in the same font and in the same size as the LaTeX text you already have used. So, and then, okay, I show you an example afterwards. I guess this one is a bit low, but when you do that, you have to set a local graphics path to the, actually, because you transclude or you include the tech file, that's what you have as input, and that one needs to know where the EPS file is. So then you have to set a local graphics path in here. I'll show you a bit later on how it's done. So, if I want to produce a simple LaTeX plot, I start off with setting the terminal. I set the name of the output file, and then I plot the function sinus of x from minus 3.14 to 3.14. I run the script using gnuplot and then simple.gp. And to include that, this is the LaTeX code I use to produce the next frame. So yeah, start the frame, set the frame title, which is LaTeX. And then start the figure, start centering as you would do normally. But this line here, I set input, I would like to have the tech file I produced from this one that produces the output of the tech file. And I also need to tell this the produce tech file where it can find the produce EPS file. And when I run that code here, my next slide looked like this. It's not perfect, I admit that, but you see, I get it in at least. But okay, I would like to have it a bit smaller, so I would like to set the size, and you could also have a bit more wider y-axis. So to do that, I make another script, then I set the terminal, and then I set the size to be 10 times 6 centimeters. I know already that from here to here is roughly 13 by 10 centimeters in total, so it should fit within the screen. I set the output name as before, set some ranges to the different axes, and I also add a label to the different axes, and then finally just write plot and then the function. I run the function as before, typing gnuplot and then simple2.gp. I save that as simple2. And I included in the next frame using this latte code there. Not much change, except I changed the name of the input file here. And then you see it at least fit within the page. Could do a bit more. It's more interesting to see the p values here. And also this line, is the color is not so nice, and this legend collides with the line. So same as before, same size, give it another name. Set here, I set how many digits I want for the x-axis. Set the range from minus p to p, and then also add the x-ticks using p as a reference, and the step size is p half. Yeah, and then run the script again. I have to do that each time, and then to include the product of this one, same as before, but change the name of this file here to be same as this one here. So the produced slide looks like this. I have a bit wider one. This is, by the way, this is the same color as the NTNU color, of course. And I also have different ranges here for the ticks. So finally, I don't use gnuplot if I want to do something very simple. So if I have, for instance, if I'm running Python, or MATLAB, I just type plot x.y, and then I get the output data. What I like to do with gnuplot is to produce plots which I can include in papers or presentation and things like that. But what I have noticed that almost all my plots look pretty much the same. So I can automate this procedure using a script with inputs. So I can set the terminal from the outside. Here is some data that I use every time. I set what kind of output, give it a variable name, and also which input file. So I can change the file I want to plot from the outside. So when I want to do that, I type to run this script then. I type gnuplot minus e, and then the name of the output file, which is normal.tech, the name of the input file, the data file. And also here I select what terminal I would like to use from the outside. So the important thing to do then is to include the minus e, which says that you can do expressions. So then I get this plot here. And could often be quite useful to have a grayscale version. So then I use exactly the same script. I don't change anything to that one. I just add this monochrome keyboard here to the terminal. So then I produce it in black and white. Or I can use another terminal if I want to do that. For instance, PNG Kaibo, which I use here, and produces a PNG file. So, to conclude, I would say that gnuplot is more or less its separate language for producing plots. It's very flexible, and you can do almost anything with it. It could be, and you could do it also, and it starts to look well. Can be a bit difficult to get started, but once you have know how to use Gnuplot, you don't have to worry anything more about plotting. So, thank you for your attention. Yeah, that was my presentation. Yeah.
So when you use the EPS package to create the text document that you later include in the LaTeX document,
yeah.
So if you use PDF LaTeX, then you want to create, you want to use PNG font, right? Because it's a graphic package that's running this. But does the include graphics take care of this?
You don't use include graphics. You use input instead. So that is, as I said there, you use this, instead of using include graphics, you use input. So you take in this tech file that you produce.
And you're still using the EPS?
You use the EPS file, yeah.
And that's OK?
Yeah, that works. Produce this one using PDF LaTeX. So that's not the problem. I guess most of them have this included, that EPS to PDF package is usually included in all different document class you produce with PDF LaTeX. But yeah, it shouldn't be any problem. So, but the important thing to remember then is to set a local graphics path here. So this file that you are transcluding, which means you're copy-pasting into your run as your own code, it needs to know where it could find the figure. Because so that's why you set the graphics path. And that is the same as you see here. When I produce, run this code here, I produce a tech file, and I also produce an EPS file, which is located, this plain EPS file here, which is located just next to the text file. So, needs to remember that.
Because normally, if you wanted to include an EPS file in a LaTeX document and use the PDF LaTeX, then you would get an error, right?
Still? Sometimes there is a problem, but if you also include the EPS to PDF package. So what it does now, that it produces a PDF that is included, but it does it automatically for you. Well. Any other questions or? Yeah?
Could you show how this tech file that you include looks like?
Yeah, I can, but let's see. I don't have any here. So this is the tech file which is produced by Gnuplot. I have not touched this file at all. It's automatically produced by Gnuplot. So it's just to use the classical input, and then you get this file here. So you could also copy paste it into where you want your figure to be produced, but it's a long file. Not really sure of the contents there. Yep. But it's possible, or it's designed to be just included as in backslash input. So it's quite handy.
Okay, are there any more pressing questions from the audience? With that, if you have anything else, just see Tobias afterwards. And at this point, please help yourself to some pizza and some soft drinks, and thanks for coming.
Thank you.
Thank you, Toby.
Thank you. Thank you.
Great presentation.
Thank you.